Good evening and welcome to the show. This is the second show. And I don't know why, but we didn't get any complaints about the first show. We're either getting cleaner or nobody's watching the show. An American in Dublin goes up to a little drunk and he says, "Excuse me, sir, but why do you have those yellow lines down the side of the pavement?"
And he says, "They're to signify there's no parking at all."
And he said, "The double yellow line?"
She said, "It signifies there's no parking at all, at all."
You get a drunk who arrives home very late at night. He's carrying a bottle of whiskey in his back pocket. And coming up the stairs, he trips, boom, breaks the bottle, cuts his bum to pieces. He sneaks up to his bedroom, drops his, and he's trying to put the bits of plaster on his bum. And he can't see, so he has a look in the mirror. He's going, "Ah." Puts them all on, goes to bed. In the morning, the wife comes in, and she says, "You were drunk last night." He said, "Oh, I was not." She said, "What's all that sticking plaster on the mirror?" Many Irish people have been known to join what is known as the British Army. People like Wellington, Montgomery, Kitchener, Alexander, all Irish fellas. Story about an Irish fellow comes back after the war and he's got a stack of medals, 80 all down route. And they said, "Good, you must be a terrible brave fella to get all them medals." I said, I'm not brave at all. I'm just an ordinary fella." He said, "I'm not. My God, you must be. You must be. I know how you heroes are. You don't like to talk about it, do you?" He said, "No." He said, "I'm not really brave." He says, "Well, all right then. Tell us, how did you get that first medal?" He said, "Well, I got that one by a mistake. Complete mistake. I mean, they thought I was somebody else and they gave me the medal." He says, "All right, I'll go with that one. But how did you get all the others?" He said, "Well, I got all the others because I got that one." Get the Irish fellow who's the father of 18 children, Catholic. Because we don't have any of that pills and all that rubbish. We are allowed to have sex, but we are not allowed to enjoy it. We do it to propagate, bring little Catholic children in. That's the whole purpose. They say to us from the pulpit, "Do it, but don't enjoy it." So what we do, we go off, we get drunk, we come back, we do it. We don't know whether we've enjoyed it or not. Anyhow, this fella's got 18 children. And he says to his wife, he said, "If you have another child," he said, "I'm going to hang myself. I will." And a year later, she has another one. And he said, "I'll hang myself." He said, "No, I won't. I'll give myself a reprieve. But if it happens again, I'll hang myself." And a year later, she has another child. And he says, "That's it." Gets the chair, puts the rope over the beam, around his neck, and he's just about to jump. And he says, "Hang on a second. You might be hanging the wrong man." It's too
two brothers in Ireland. They have a shop, and they've been burgled a few times. So one of them's reading the paper one day, and he hears about guard dogs. He reads a little advert, said guard dogs. So one of the brothers says, go down there and get one of them guard dogs to guard the shop. That's what we want. And the fellow goes down, and there's a Japanese fellow, breeds these dogs. And he said, I'd like to see one of your guard dogs. He said, oh, so you want to see our guard dog? Okay. And he brings out a little peek. And the fellow says, is that a guard dog? He said, he not only a great guard dog. He great, great guard dog. The fellow says, a bloody bull of wool. I'd kick that thing to Tipperary, I would. He said, oh, no, you wouldn't. He might look very simple, but this little doggy karate expert. He said, what are you talking about? That little thing there, karate. He said, I show you. And he gets a little plank of wood. He holds it up and says to the little dog, karate dog, karate expert, strike off. The little dog goes up on his hind legs and goes... He says, sure, anybody can break a piece of wood. So he said, oh, I got brick. I got big brick. He gets a big brick. Holds it up in front of the dog and says, karate expert. Karate expert. Ha! Boom! Smashes the brick to pieces. And the fellow says, I'll have the dog. He takes it home. And the fellow brother says, did you get the guard dog? He said, I did. There he is. Put him down there. He said, that? A guard dog? You're bloody out of your head. He said, he's not only a guard dog, he's a karate expert. He said, karate expert, my foot. Oh, oh, oh.
Any job you do can become boring. I mean, I actually do get very bored telling jokes. Only because I've heard them before. But any job can become boring. But there's always something, there's some moment somewhere along that job where everything becomes worthwhile.
Okay. You can do your shirt up now.
Sure.
Do you smoke?
No, thanks. I just had one.
Smoke, huh? Like a drink?
No, I had a skinful before lunch.
A heavy drinker. How about sex?
Now, that's something I never say no to.
Lot 36, this magnificent Dekar cuckoo clock from the workshops of Johann Glucker, Zurich. This item is unique inasmuch as it is the first cuckoo clock ever to have been made. It is therefore very rare and of tremendous value. Now, may I have a bit, please? Shall we say 5,000 guineas? 5,000 guineas, thank you, sir. 6,000 guineas. 7,000 guineas. 7,500 guineas. 7,000 pounds. Now, let's start again, shall we?
Oi! Can't you read?
What?
It says no swimming!
I'm not swimming! I'm drowning!
That's all right, then.
Nobody move. This is a hijack.
He said, nobody move. This is a hijack. Oh, you. Oh, hijack the plane. You.
I'll name you this child.
If you ask anybody why he works, they'll always say, I work to survive. Consider the way of the animals. The bee, busy bee, the industrious ant, the beaver. I would like to tell you, if I may, the fable of the two bears who woke from hibernation. One was a frivolous bear and one was an industrious bear. And the frivolous bear loved the sunshine and ran after the little butterflies, climbed the trees, splashed about the water. The industrious bear was eating berries, honey, getting fatter and fatter and fatter, catching the salmon. The frivolous little bear was going, having a super time. And then the north winds began to blow, and the leaves began to fall from the trees, and it began to get colder. And the industrious bear had built up his fat to carry him right through the hibernation for the following winter. And the frivolous bear was all skinny and thin. And the fat, industrious bear looked at the little frivolous one, and he said, I hope you've learned something from this. While you gallivanted in the summer enjoying yourself, I was industrious. I fed myself so that I would live on through the winter. Now I am going to go into my cave and go into a long, long sleep. And he did. Made himself comfortable and went fast asleep with all that fat to feed him through the winter. The skinny, frivolous bear followed him in and looked at him and thought, you big, fat, smug bear. And he ate him and then went to sleep. But what about a man who's worked all his life for the advancement of mankind, only in turn to be rejected by mankind?
You can't park here, sir.
Park? You talk about parking, I have just invented a time machine, which those fools have rejected. And you talk about parking?
Do you realize that by touching this knob, I can make you disappear?
Well, I still say you can't park here, sir.
Thank you.
fools laughed at my machine. Oh, the friend of a horn there.
I'm afraid you can't talk it.
Well, if that old man with that box can go back in history, why can't we? Well, we can, and we will.
Look what I've invented.
What is it?
I'll call it the donut.
Tell me, sire, a thing that I have always been curious about. Why do they call you the Black Prince?
I have no idea, man.
Two to the east, two to the west, three to the north, three to the south.
You ready, lads?
Right, old fucking
eye. Good night.
What shall we do with it?
That's it. That's it.
I just had a thought. I wonder what it was.
Jack, have you made a solemn promise not to watch as the fair Lady Godiva rides down the main street of our city?
But, Squire, she'd be naked!
Aye, that's why I've got you all crammed into this tavern, where I can keep an eye on you and see that you keep your prying, lascivious, filthy eyes to yourselves.
And not all of us, Squire.
What do you mean, man?
Ebenezer Hampton and his brother Rupert bain't be here, Squire, and they be devils with them women folk.
Ebenezer and Rupert Hampton.
Right, right.
Aye!
Michael's never been the same since Jackie sat on him there. People are very curious about the unknown, which you must admit is very logical, because there's no sense in being curious about something you know about. And I have been known to tell what one would call stories about the unknown or the spiritual world. And I actually had a letter from somebody, a woman, who wrote and said, please don't tell any more ghost stories. Or if you do, don't howl like a wolf. Because the last time you did it, it cost me a pair of tights. And
Now, I thought exactly what you were thinking. And I wrote and asked her how I cost her a pair of tights, and she explained that she always watched the show with her tabby cat, which used to sit on her lap, fast asleep. And when I howled, I went, oh, no, this cat went, yeah! It probably cost that lady another pair of tights. But when one talks about the unknown, I, many years ago, was rather foolish, and we were in the west coast of Ireland, and we were in a bar, and we'd had a couple of drinks, and somebody started to talk about the unknown, the spirit world. And the conversation came up about the gravedigger's house. And the locals started to tell us about it. And this gravedigger was found in his bed, dead, with terrible marks upon his neck, and his eyes wide open. And the doctor said that the marks had nothing to do with his death, but that the man had died of fright. And I scoffed. Foolishly. And it came about with a few more drinks and everything else that I accepted a dare or a bet that I would stay the night in the cottage beside the graveyard. And I went there, and we agreed that the door would be locked and I would stay in there till first light. And I was locked in. And I don't know really what happens, but I think a great deal of fear is in one's mind. It was dank. It was cold. The effects of the booze began to wear off. And I began to think, what the name of God are you doing? And I felt, I don't know what it was an instinct, it was something stronger than me, pulled me towards this bed where this man had died. And I was drawn, I fought against it, and I was drawn nearer and nearer to this bed. And I was told somehow or another to sit on that bed. I didn't want to, and I did. And an unnatural drowsiness came over me. And I became very sleepy. And I laid down, knowing full well that I shouldn't. And I went to sleep, a limbo sleep. And I woke. What time? I have no idea. The candle had burned down. It was black. It was cold. And I felt a presence. I was completely sober by then and utterly terrified. The heckles on the back of my neck had begun to rise. I was paralyzed by a presence of fear. And I felt something on my chest begin to move. It crept slowly up my chest, and I couldn't move. It came closer and closer to my throat. I gathered all my willpower as this thing came closer and nearer, and I grabbed it, and it was wet and cold, and I bit it. Screamed with pain. And that is how I lost my face. The sketches in this show are what we normally call them quickies, and we have all sorts of different type of quickies. We've got long quickies, and we've got short quickies. We've got slow quickies. We've got slow, slow, quick, quick, slow. And the next batch of quickies, which I'm about to show you, are what we call very brief, quick quickies. Did you enjoy them? Oh, you missed them. We'll show them again.
Good evening. This is the 9 o'clock news. At least it would be if we had any news. As we don't, there will be a short musical interlude before the next program.
Hello.
Here is a newsflash. A well-known musician has just been shot. We'll bring you further details as soon as possible.
Good morning, madam. A colleague of mine called on you recently to ask you some questions about your sex life for a survey called Sex and the Suburban Housewife. I wonder if I could ask you some supplementary questions.
Of course. Are you from the same survey?
No, madam. I'm from the Guinness Book of Records. Give me a whiskey.
Fall!
Bill's leg's gone. Get Tommy ready.
Come on, Tom. Get ready, you're on.
Hey, Mr. Broadbent, you really going to let me go on?
Yes.
After 4 years. 4 years in the reserve, sitting on this bench, at last they're going to play with the first team.
You good? Come on, get on.
Thank you, sir.
I don't know what we're going to do. We've never ever been able to ever make ends meet, have we? It's all your damn fault for not earning enough anyway.
Oh, don't start.
Don't you threaten me, you weak cowering little man. I've given you the best years of my life. You've got no drive, no ambition, that's your trouble.
Right, this is a hold-up. Get back. Look, come. Look,
look, look.
Anybody moves, she gets it.
General's compliments, huh? How are the men in your section?
Dreadful. It's this confounded heat. They're going down like flies.
Every comedian has his own sense of humor. He likes to tell gags in that vein. My sense of humor is comprised around five subjects: life, death, drinking, religion, and the English. So if anybody knows a gag about an English priest who lived and died, would you kindly tell me about it, please? Strange gags that kind of tickle one's fancy. This story about an Irish commando during the war dropped into Germany, was captured by the SS and taken for interrogation. And the door is closed, and from inside you hear, "How did you get to Germany? What unit do you belong to? Who sent you? What information are you seeking for in Germany?" You don't answer. You will tell us eventually. What unit do you belong to? Why did you come to Germany? What did you get in here? How? Why and what? I will continue to ask you. Why? How and what? And kindly stop hitting me when I'm asking you. I'm not doing gags like that anymore. You get a fellow who all his life has been left with two choices. Everything he's wanted to do, he's been given a choice in. He had a choice of going to two universities, Cambridge or Oxford. And he picked the wrong one and went to Oxford. He had a choice of taking two degrees And he chose the wrong one. He had a choice of two girls. And he chose the nag. He had a choice of two jobs. He picked the one without the possibilities of promotion. And eventually, after 20 years, he's sitting there and he's thinking, that's it. I've had my choice all my life and I've made the wrong one. I'm getting out. I'm going to start fresh. He goes to London Airport, looks up the planes, and he's got a choice of two planes. He picks the plane and he picks the wrong one. 20,000 feet up. The captain comes through and he said, I'm terribly sorry, we've just lost engines 2, 3, and 4, and one will go in the next 7 minutes. The fellow drops on his knees and says, St. Francis, help me! And a voice from heaven said, St. Francis of Assisi or St. Francis of Xavier? When I was a boy, actually, the best favor anybody could do would be to take me to the pictures. I was brought up on people like Ronald Coleman and Earl Flynn and Will Rogers and Hopalong Cassidy. I even remember John Wayne when he had his own hair. They say there was a great days of Hollywood. And people say they don't make pictures like that anymore. And they're right. They don't, but we do.
Now, according to intelligence, the Cheyenne and the Pawnees are going to meet up round about here, Scott's Bluff. Now, if we can get there with a squadron of cavalry, we can...
Sir! Water!
Canteen, Lieutenant! Water, soldier! What happened, soldier?
It was a massacre, sir. The men didn't stand a chance. The Sioux Indians wiped out the whole platoon. They captured me, but they didn't kill me.
Why not?
Red Arrow sent me back with a message, sir. 8 days. 8 days of riding without drinking.
Sure, get on with it, Kincaid. Get on.
The heat and the dust.
Yeah, yeah, but what was Red Arrow's message, soldier?
Oyona! Fuyan Sang Da! Fuyan! Kanada!
And what does that mean?
I don't know, sir.
That's it. That's the tempo.
Cards.
One card.
Fold up. Mary Lou, get upstairs.
Okay, man, the stage will be along pretty soon, so get outside and take up your positions.
Just a moment, Blackjack. Who says you give orders? Who says you're the leader of this outfit? Do you reckon you could do a better job of it? I sure do. Okay, kid. I reckon it's about time we got this thing straightened out. Fellas, where do you stand?
I stand with Blackjack.
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 Fear not, Lady Rowena. I, Sir Jasper, shall rescue you.
Aha!
Sir Lionel, I have come to rescue the Lady Rowena.
I do not think so, Sir Jasper. The only way the Lady Rowena will get out of this tower is over my dead body. Well, and I do not foresee an early death.
We shall see about that. Sir Lionel?
Sir Jasper?
Just like a woman. There is a basic difference between men and women. If you don't know what it is by now, there's no sense of me telling you. But I actually do think, God bless the women. Where would we be without you?
Free!
One of the complaints continually leveled by women is that they do not have equality. And if you don't need equality, who needs it? I mean, we get up when you come into a room, we give you chairs, we let you sit down. Carry your bags, buy your booze, buy your clothes, dinner, carry you over the threshold, literally put you on a pedestal. And you live 5 years longer than us. Are you surprised with all that humping and carrying? The basic difference between men and women is not physical, it's in here, it's the logic. The logic of women is bizarre.
A couple of years ago, my wife bought me 2 ties for Christmas.
Christmas morning, I got up, I put a clean shirt on, I put one of the ties on, I go downstairs and I said, do you like it? She said, what's the matter with the other one? I met a woman one day and I said to her, I believe you're one of those people who always answer a question with a question. She said, who told you that? Get a young lady who's getting married and goes to her mother for guidance or counsel. Says, Mummy, I'm terribly embarrassed about getting undressed in front of Charles on our first wedding. And she said, well, don't worry about it, darling, because men understand these things. Your daddy did, and I believe your granddaddy did. When they arrive in the honeymoon suite, they will look at you and they will say, oh, I have to go downstairs and get some cigarettes. And while they're away, then you... and prepare yourself. And they arrive at the hotel. The bridal suite, And she looks at him and he goes, I seem to have come up without any cigarettes. I'll just pop down and get some cigarettes. And off he goes. And she goes, whoosh! Makeup. Into the bed, all the pillows puffed up, sitting there. And he comes back in and he says, what are you doing there? We haven't had lunch yet. And even with making love, there's got to be intrigue. A couple loving in the big house, and she said, if you're going to make love, we will do it differently. We have a vast big house. And what we'll do, we'll play hide and seek. I'll hide and you seek me. And when you find me, you can seduce me. I said, what if I can't find you? She said, I'll be in the cupboard under the stairs. I'll tell you the one place where women are not truly emancipated in any way whatsoever, and that is within the Church of Rome. Women are not allowed to officiate in any way during the Mass or the confession. Thank God. Can you imagine a nun taking confession?
He said he'd never been out with another woman, and yet he accused me of being unfaithful to him. He did.
Oh, the nerve. And what did you say?
Well, I told him exactly. I'm completely mistaken. I'm not promised to listen. No, it's not like other people in my neighbourhood.
You know that Mrs. Baker, don't you?
Mrs. Baker.
The woman
can't wish
to come to me. She's like, did you come here? Oh, yeah.
I told you about it.
Thank you, and may your God go with you.